What's up?
So we have a few subtypes of acute myeloid leukemia. Clinically, they are very similar, but two leukemias have some specific features. It's acute promyelocytic leukemia that causes DAC, and acute myelomonocytic leukemia that can cause gingival infiltration. So here we will discuss the pathogenesis of common clinical symptoms of all myeloid leukemias. Recall that hematopoiesis can be subdivided on myelopoiesis and lymphopoiesis. Myelopoiesis can be subdivided on erythropoiesis that produce red blood cells, thrombopoiesis that produce megakaryocytes from which platelets are formed, monocytopoiesis that produce monocytes, and granulopoiesis that produce neutrophils, basophils, and eosinophils. The final products of lymphopoiesis are B lymphocytes and T lymphocytes. So in normal condition, to make mature neutrophils, stem cells has to undergo differentiation into common myeloid progenitor cell, and then progenitor cell undergo further differentiation into myeloblast. Myeloblast then mature into myelocyte, then into metamyelocyte, then into a band form, and only after segmented neutrophil is formed, which is the most mature form of all neutrophils. At the same fashion, we produce basophils and eosinophils. But if mutation in the stem cell occurs, and this mutation disrupts myeloblast maturation, then myeloblasts cannot mature into promyelocyte. As a result, myeloblasts begin to accumulate inside the bone marrow. In normal condition, the amount of myeloblasts inside the bone marrow is approximately 2%. In acute leukemia, because of mutation, myeloblasts progressively accumulate, and the amount of blood cells inside the bone marrow becomes greater than 20%. And moreover, their quantity with time continues to increase. So the first feature of acute myeloid leukemia is increase in amount of myeloblasts inside the bone marrow. In addition to this, because myeloblasts cannot mature into promyelocytes, the amount of more mature forms of granulocytes begin to decrease. Initially, the amount of promyelocytes decrease, then myelocytes decrease, then metamyelocytes decrease, and then bands decrease. At this point, so-called leukemic hiatus develops. And finally, when mature granulocytes die of old age, the amount of fully mature granulocytes decrease. Decrease in mature neutrophils put patient at risk of bacterial infection. At the same fashion, the amount of other granulocytes decrease. And as we know, decrease in mature eosinophils increase the risk of parasitic infections. So simultaneously with accumulation of myeloblasts, the amount of neutrophils decrease, and neutropenia increase the risk of bacterial infections. The problem with blast cells in the bone marrow is that they are very large cells that take a lot of space. And because of this, they crowd out all other cells from the bone marrow. We can imagine bone marrow as a space that is fully packed with cells in normal proportions. So in normal condition, bone marrow is 100% packed with cells in normal proportions. And in normal condition, myeloblasts take up only 2% from all space of the bone marrow. So other 98% of space is taken by all other cells, as lymphoid cells, erythroid cells, cells from thrombocyte lineage, and monocytes. But now with mutation that disrupts maturation, the amount of blood cells increase and becomes 20%, for example. And because bone marrow is already fully packed with cells, there is no vacant space. And blood cells in this state force normal cells to leave the bone marrow. As a result, the amount of all other cells in the bone marrow progressively decrease. And very important here is that the higher becomes the quantity of blood cells, the lesser space is left for normal cells, so the higher will be the amount of normal cells that are forced to leave.
I want exactly what you want. I want everything.
Would that include a bullet from this gun?
Go ahead, shoot. The best thing about being me, there's so many me's.
So how it affects hematopoiesis? Increase in amount of myeloblasts crowd out erythroid cells. Thereby, the production of red blood cells will decrease. Decrease in amount of red blood cells will cause decrease in concentration of hemoglobin, and decrease in blood hemoglobin we call anemia. So, as myeloblasts crowd out erythroid cells, the production of red blood cells decrease, and this will cause anemia. So, patients with acute leukosis will have typical anemic symptoms. Anemia will manifest with weakness, fatigue, shortness of breath during physical exercises. Also, patients with anemia will have a pale skin and pale conjunctiva. Also, if anemia progresses, new symptoms begin to appear. It's lightheadedness, headaches, severe fatigue, shortness of breath even at rest, and irregular heartbeats. Also, myeloblasts crowd out cells from the thrombocyte lineage, and as a result, thrombocytopenia develops. So, simultaneously, myeloblasts begin to crowd out the precursors of platelets. And as a result, the production of platelets decrease, and decrease in platelets we call thrombocytopenia. Thrombocytes provide the primary hemostasis, so with low platelet count, patient will have disrupted primary hemostasis. Disruption of primary hemostasis manifests with increase in bleeding time. Also, it causes bleeding from mucous membranes, primarily from GI tract, but also frequently they have a nose bleeding, so-called epistaxis. And microhemorrhages develops that on skin manifest with petechia, purpura and ecchymosis. In addition to this, myeloblasts will crowd out monocytic cells that will cause monocytopenia. And monocytopenia increases the risk of bacterial infections. So because myeloblasts crowd out monocytic cells, this will cause monocytopenia that predispose to bacterial infections. And last but not least, myeloblasts crowd out lymphoblasts from the bone marrow. As a result, the production of lymphocytes decrease and lymphopenia develops. And as we know, lymphopenia increases the risk of viral infections. So, accumulation of myeloblasts also crowd out lymphoblasts from the bone marrow. As a result, lymphopenia develops. And lymphopenia increases the risk of viral infections. Neutropenia and lymphopenia together also increase the risk of fungal infections. As we see in acute leukosis, all cells in the peripheral blood decrease, and this condition we call pancytopenia, which is quite specific for acute leukemia. We said that blood cells crowd out normal cells from the bone marrow, but the question is, where do these normal cells go? Because once they leave the bone marrow, they have to find a shelter. And from the bone marrow, in search for a shelter, cells come back to places that were once the site of hematopoiesis before the bone marrow. Initially it's splenic tissue, so a lot of cells migrate to the spleen. And with increasing amount of cells in the splenic tissue, the size of the spleen increase, and enlargement of the spleen we call splenomegaly. Splenomegaly manifests with abdominal discomfort and early satiety that cause loss of appetite. With abdominal discomfort, everything is clear. Obviously, if patient has enlarged spleen, it will compress anatomical structures nearby and it will cause discomfort. But how to explain loss of appetite? Usually, when we consume food, this food incomes to the stomach, where it puts pressure on the gastric walls, and exactly this pressure of food that causes distension of the gastric walls gives us a sense of satiety. But in case of splenomegaly, the larger becomes the spleen, the more it compresses the stomach. And the more compressed is the stomach, the smaller becomes the stomach volume. So the lesser food is needed to increase intragastric pressure and thereby to cause distension of the gastric walls. So the lesser food is needed to provoke a sense of satiety. And because of that, patients with splenomegaly have loss of appetite. And obviously, decrease in food consumption potentially can cause decrease in body weight.
Have I made myself clear, boys?
Yeah, that's perfectly clear, Mickey, yeah. Just give me 1 minute to confer with my colleague. Did you understand a single word of what he just said?
Another serious problem is that at some point spleen becomes so large that a condition called hypersplenism develops.
What?
The concept here is that the larger becomes the spleen, the more active becomes splenic macrophages. And at some point, enlargement of the spleen overstimulates macrophages. And now they begin to consume by phagocytosis normal red blood cells and platelets from the blood. And this results in their destruction. So the more severe becomes acute leukemia, the larger becomes the spleen. The higher is the chance that splenic macrophages will cause rapid and premature destruction of red blood cells and platelets. So hypersplenism can cause destruction of red blood cells and platelets that aggravates anemia and thrombocytopenia that are already present. Also, a lot of cells migrate to lymph nodes, and with increasing amount of cells in the lymph nodes, the size of the lymph nodes increase, and enlargement of the lymph nodes in different regions of the body we call generalized lymphadenopathy. And if spleen and lymph nodes are fully filled with cells, then cells are going into another previous place of hematopoiesis, which is liver. And now they will progressively accumulate also in the liver tissue, so the size of the liver will increase, and enlargement of the liver we call hepatomegaly. Also, the specific feature of myeloblasts is that they're sticky cells.
Now we got our new nickname. We're the sticky bandits!
And because in acute myeloid leukemia, the malignant cells are sticky, they stick to microvessels as capillaries. And such high amount of pathological blood cells can cause obturation of the vessel, this condition called leukostasis. Most commonly, leukostasis results in pulmonary infiltration or in obturation of the small vessels in the central nervous system. Such huge amount of blood cells produce huge amount of pro-inflammatory cytokines, and increase in cytokines level can cause a so-called B symptoms, it's fever and night sweats. Also, such huge amount of blood cells in the bone marrow put a great amount of pressure on the bone tissue, and sometimes it can manifest as bone pain.
Great. Fine. Yep.
Ciao.
What's that mean?
Ciao.
It's Italian. It means food.